Hello everyone, today I will be discussing on directional drilling. The table of contents for the following sessions are drilling parameters, fundamentals of directional drilling, applications of directional drilling, types of directional wells and its calculations, dogleg severity, wellbore deflection techniques, survey instruments and calculations, geosteering, horizontal wells, and multilateral well completion. I will be discussing these 10 points throughout my directional drilling session. I will be putting out these videos in various parts. Coming to the drilling parameters, we will be discussing weight on bit, RPM or rotation per minute, ROP or rate of penetration, standpipe pressure, pump stroke, hook load, drilling torque, flow rate, and return flow. It's very essential for us to know about these parameters in detail, because we would be using these concepts in when we are discussing our advanced topics. Alright, so we should be well aware of all these concepts. Coming to weight on bit, it is the part of the weight of the entire drill string assembly that has been suspended on bit and ultimately on the formation. It is generally expressed in terms of pounds or tons. Hook load equal to drill stem weight plus weight on bit. So this is the formula to find out the hook load, which is the summation of drill stem weight and weight on bit. If someone is asking what would be the maximum hook load, then at that time it will be drill stem weight when my weight on bit equal to zero. Okay, so this is how you find out the hook load maximum. Okay, now let's discuss. There are two cases over here, case A and case B. Now in case A, that my bit has not yet touched the formation. All right, and now at that time, if someone is asking me what would be the weight on bit over here, the weight on bit would be zero, obvious, because the bit has not yet touched the formation. Now if someone is asking what would be the hook load, then at that time my hook load will be the total weight of the drill string, very obvious, because my bit has not yet touched the formation. That's why my weight on bit is zero. And at that time, if I want to calculate my hook load, it would be equal to 50 tons or whatever be the drill stem weight. In this case, it is 50 tons. Now, coming to case B. In case B, you can see that I am giving a weight. I am giving weight on bit, okay? Weight on bit of 10 tons has been given in this particular case, okay? So this is my case B, when I'm giving weight on bit of 10 ton. Okay, at that time, if I want to find out the hook load, that would be equal to my drill string weight plus my weight on bit. Alright, okay. Now, let's discuss the second case, which is RPM or rotations per minute. Now, it is the rate at which the string is rotating. Very simple, okay. That means, as we know, when we are drilling, we would be obviously rotating our string. Okay, so at what rate that particular string is being rotated, that is our RPM. All right, okay. Now, it is expressed in terms of rotations per minute. Per minute, how much rotations we are giving, it is expressed in that term. Now, as we all know, there are two types of systems. One is my rotary drive system and second is a top drive system. All right, now, as we know, in rotary drive system, we will be having a rotary table. And that rotary table, by using that rotary table, we are giving the rotation to that particular string. Alright, okay. Now, when it comes to a top drive system, at that time, the rotation to the string is provided by the inbuilt motors, which is present in the top drive system. Got it? Okay. Now, coming to the third drilling parameter, which is my rate of penetration. Now, rate of penetration is simply the drilling rate, okay? The rate at which you are drilling a particular well, that is my rate of penetration. It indicates the depth where we have penetrated inside the earth in an hour, okay? Now, it is expressed in terms of meter per hour or feet per hour, okay? How much depth you have drilled in an hour, that's our rate of penetration. Now, let's discuss a case over here. I have two different formations, alright? One is a sandstone formation, and second is a shale formation. Alright, so this is my sandstone formation and this is my shale formation. All right. Now both these formations are located at the same depth. All the parameters, that means mud weight and everything, has been kept constant. Okay. Now I'm drilling. I have two different rigs over here. I've reached this point, and for this well also I've reached this particular point. All right. Okay. Now over here, what I want to explain you is that even based on the type of formation also, my rate of penetration will vary. For example, if I'm drilling through this sandstone formation, let's say my rate of penetration will be around, let's say 30 meter in an hour. Okay. Now that means I've given a particular torque, I've given a particular weight on, but everything has been kept constant. Okay. Now for sandstone, I am having a 30 meter per hour rate of penetration. Now in that for same case, that means for same depth, for all the parameters having been considered constant, if I'm drilling through the shale formation, then my rate of penetration will be around 10 meter per hour. It would be less than 30 meter per hour. Okay. The reason is shale is a comparatively a very difficult formation to drill. Okay. So that's why my ROP or my rate of penetration will be very, very low when I'm drilling through a shale formation. All right. Okay. So that's about rate of penetration. And again, rate of penetration will depend on the type of formation also. Now let's move further. Now coming to standpipe pressure, it is the pressure loss of the system indicated at the standpipe manifold gauge. Now as you all know, in the drilling floor we will be having a standpipe manifold gauge. At that point we can measure this standpipe pressure. The standpipe manifold is located on the rig floor. It is slightly less than the mud pump pressure. Okay, let's say if I'm having a mud pump over here, if I'm having a mud pump, okay, and if I'm having a standpipe pressure being recorded over here, that means let's say if my mud pump is pumping at 2500 psi, then my standpipe pressure would be around 2200 psi. That means 300 psi has been lost over here. Okay, that means in the surface line, let this be a standpipe. Okay, let this be the standpipe. Okay, that means in this case, from the mud pump, when I'm pumping at 2500 psi, and if I'm getting a 2200 psi recorded, being recorded at the standpipe gauge, when my mud takes the journey from the mud pump till the standpipe, in that surface land itself, I am experiencing a loss of 300 psi. Okay, so this particular loss can be identified by having a standpipe pressure gauge at present at the standpipe in the rig floor. Now, coming to pump stroke, it is the rate at which the mud pump piston is moving to pump the drilling fluid in the drill string. Okay, very obvious. It is expressed in strokes per minute or SPM. Every stroke pumps a calculated volume of mud inside the drill string. More the number of strokes in a minute, more is the volume of the fluid pumped inside the string in a minute. Obvious. Now, so the mud pump SPM can be increased to increase the discharge rate. It is also commonly expressed in terms of liters per minute or barrel per minute or gallon per minute of the drilling fluid to the pumps. Okay, so this particular concept is very important when it comes to gate preparation. Okay, we will be discussing various numericals related to this pump strokes and different times. Okay, so we will be having a duplex, we will be discussing numericals on duplex pump, triplex, etc., etc. All right. Okay, now let's move further. As of now coming to hook load, it is the total weight of the components hanging on the traveling block. Okay, very simple. Total weight of the components hanging on the traveling block. Now, it is usually expressed in terms of pounds per ton. In case while we are using a top drive system, my hook load will be equal to weight of block plus weight of top drive system plus my weight of drill string. Now, in case when I am using a Kelly, that means when I am going for a rotary system, rotary drive system, at that time my hook load will be equal to weight of block plus weight of swivel assembly plus weight of drill string. Okay, because in Kelly, when we are using a Kelly, at that time we will be using this swivel also. Okay, so this is how you calculate hook load when I am having a top drive system, and secondly when I am having a rotary drive system. All right. Okay, now let's move further. Now let's discuss drilling torque. While drilling the formation, the bit experiences a torque which opposes the motion of the bit. Now, this is the torque acting between the drill string and the formation due to the hardness of the formation. Okay, it's a very important term. ड्रिलिंग टॉर्क इज अ पैरामीटर विच डिपेंड्स ऑन द फॉर्मेशन हार्डनेस राइट. ऑल्सो एट द सेम टाइम द ड्रिल स्ट्रिंग इज इन कॉन्टैक्ट विद द वेलबोर वॉल एंड द ड्रिल मड अलॉन्ग विद द कटिंग सस्पेंडेड एंड ओके राइट. नाउ दे ऑल्सो अपोज द रोटेशन ऑफ द स्ट्रिंग. द टोटल टॉर्क ऑन द स्ट्रिंग एंड बिट इज कॉल्ड द ड्रिलिंग टॉर्क. इट कैन बी रेड ऑन द ड्रिलर कंसोल टॉर्क गेज ओके. सो ऑन द ड्रिल फ्लोर यू विल बी हैविंग अ ड्रिलर्स कंसोल एंड इन दैट ड्रिलर्स कंसोल यू कैन इजिली रीड दिस टॉर्क बीइंग जनरेटेड ओके. सो एंड इट इज जनरली एक्सप्रेस्ड इन फीट पाउंड्स और डेका न्यूटन ओके. डेका न्यूटन मीन्स 10^1 न्यूटन राइट ओके. नाउ अगेन द ड्रिलिंग टॉर्क व्हेन इट कम्स टू ड्रिलिंग टॉर्क एज वी ऑल नो व्हेन आई एम ड्रिलिंग टू द बिट my bit and the formation we are I am having a contact okay. So because of this contact I will be having some kind of a resistance to drilling. Secondly my drill string will also be contacting the will be having a contact within the formation okay. And because of this contact also there will be some sort of a resistance for drilling. And thirdly when my mud is being circulated at that time let's say I am having some sort of suspended cuttings. And those cuttings can also lead to some sort of a resistance for drilling. Okay, so these three parameters generally play part in generating a drilling torque. Okay, and this drilling torque, as we all know, can be recorded at the driller's console, which is kept at the drill floor, and it is generally expressed in terms of feet pounds or deca newton. Okay, now let's move further. Next term is a flow rate. Now it is the rate at which the drilling fluid is pumped into the drill string using the mud pump. Very simple okay. It is expressed in terms of liters per minute or gallon per minute or barrel per minute right. I will be discussing various numericals in this in coming up sessions. Next is return flow. It is the rate at which the drilling fluid is coming out of the wellbore through the flow line okay. This particular thing can be detected by the paddle sensor which is kept at the flow line okay. So this paddle sensor will be recording whatever be the return flow. And again this return flow reading of this return flow is very crucial when it comes to various well control activities okay. So it is very necessary to have this return flow being recorded. Now it is expressed in terms of percent of flow all right okay. Now let's move further. Coming to fundamentals of directional drilling. Directional drilling, this is the definition of directional drilling. The process of directing the wellbore along some trajectory to a predetermined target. Okay. Now, coming to deviation control, it's the process of keeping the wellbore contained within some prescribed limits relative to the inclination angle, horizontal excursion from the vertical or both. So these are the definitions for directional drilling and deviation control. Now I will be discussing these many terms which are related to the directional drilling, and you must be having thorough idea regarding all these terms, which is measured depth, true vertical depth, inclination, azimuth, kickoff point, service stations, course length, horizontal displacement, build rate, hold rate, drop rate, build section, tangential section, drop section, reactive torque and bit walk. Okay. So this is very crucial. Now let's look at this particular figure. It's a very important figure. Now you can see that I have drilled a well. Okay, this is my drilling rig. I have drilled a well, and you can see that I have drilled a directional well. All right. So this point. Okay, this is the point. This point is my calibushing or my rotary table or my drill floor height. All right. Okay. Now this particular point is the kickoff point. I will be discussing what is kickoff point in coming up slides. Now this particular session I have created a build section okay. That means I've started creating an inclination over this particular section okay. So in this particular section I can definitely see a continuous build in my inclination all right. Now at this particular point, see this point over here, this point is my end of build. That means I have stopped building inclination at this particular point okay. Now, as I mentioned, KOP or kickoff point would be the point from where I am actually started my inclination. Okay, that means I have started deviating from the vertical. Okay, that means from this calibushing height to the kickoff point height, I have drilled a vertical well. Now from that KOP onwards, I have started building angle. Okay. Now, throughout my build section, I will be continuously building my inclination. Okay. Now this point or the EOB is my end of build point where I have stopped building. Okay. Now coming to this particular section, which is tangent or hold. In this tangent or hold section, I will be continuously maintaining both inclination as well as azimuth. Now, this particular section over here, this is a drop section. Now, drop section means, see, from this particular point onwards, I have started dropping my inclination. Now, the vertical distance from my calibushing or a rotary table or drilling floor to the target. So, this is the target depth, okay? This point is my target depth. That means from this point, that is calibushing to the target, whatever the vertical distance has been traveled by the well, it is my TVD or total vertical depth. Alright. Now the total distance that has been drilled, that means, see, I'm indicating with this, that is this green line, I'm indicating the measured depth. This is my measured depth. Okay. That is the total distance that I have drilled from my calibushing to the target. The total distance is my measured depth. Okay. Now let's discuss all these points in detail. Now let's look at the definition of inclination. The angle of the wellbore defined by a tangent line at any point of the wellbore and a vertical line is called inclination. Definition, you can see that, let this be the trajectory. Okay. Now when I'm drawing a tangent over here, okay, from the point of intersection, if I'm plotting a vertical line, okay, so now the angle that has been formed will be my inclination. All right. So this is how you measure the inclination. Now, coming to azimuth, the azimuth of a wellbore at any point is defined as the direction of the wellbore on a horizontal plane measured clockwise from north reference. Azimuths are usually expressed in angles from 0 to 360 measured from 0 north. Alright, so let me discuss over here. So as we know, this will be my north, south, east and west. Okay. So if I'm having this particular trend, okay, now the azimuth will be 90 plus, let this be 30 degree, okay, so this would be 120. If someone is asking what will be the azimuth in this particular case, that will be equal to 120. All right okay, now if I'm having let this be the angle, okay, this, let this be 30 degree. Okay. Now, if someone is asking what will be the azimuth in this particular case, so my azimuth will be 180 plus 30, which is 210. Okay. So that means one thing that we all need to take special attention is that I will be calculating azimuth from north as a reference. Okay. So north will be my 0 degree, east will be my 90 degree, south will be 180, west will be 270, and so on. All right okay, and again a very important point, I will be always calculating this in a clockwise direction. Now let's look at the definition of KOP or kickoff point. It is defined as the point below the surface location from where the well is deflected from the vertical. Okay, as we have seen in this particular figure, vertical, when I'm deflecting it, so that particular point will be my KOP or kickoff point. Alright, okay, let's move further. Now, coming to buildup. The definition of buildup is, it is the act of increasing the inclination of the drilled hole with respect to vertical. Okay, so this is my buildup section. Build section, the portion of the hole in which the inclination angle is increased. Rate of buildup is usually expressed as the angular increase per 100 feet of measured depth. Okay, so this is the unit, that means unit is angle, that is degree per 100 feet. Okay, let x degree per 100 feet, so that would be my unit of build section. Now build up rate, it is the rate of change or degrees per 100 feet or degrees per 30 meter of the increasing angle in the hole. Okay, ultimately all these three are same thing, just I'm discussing what is the expression that we are using in the industry. Now coming to drop off, Now, drop off means it is the act of reducing the inclination of the drilled hole with respect to vertical. You can see that when I'm talking about drop section, that means I am decreasing the inclination of the well. Okay. Now, let us discuss drop section. That portion of the hole in which the inclination angle is decreased, rate of drop off is usually expressed as the angular decrease per 100 feet of measured depth. Okay. That means over here, when I'm talking about drop section, that will be angular decrease per 100 feet of measured depth. Drop off rate, the rate of change of inclination in the part of the wellbore where the inclination of the angle is purposely returned toward vertical, usually expressed in degrees per 100 feet of coast length. Okay, so this is my drop off rate. All right, okay. Coming to hold section, that means tangent or hold section, it's one and the same. The act of maintaining the inclination and the azimuth of the wellbore to remain constant as it is. Okay, that means I'm neither changing the inclination nor my azimuth. Now coming to tangent or hold section, the portion of the hole in which the inclination azimuth is maintained at the same throughout the section. Again, obvious, as I have discussed it. Let's move further. Now let's discuss closure. It is the shortest horizontal distance from a particular survey station back to the reference point. Okay. First of all, I should discuss survey point. Now let's say I have drilled a well. Okay, this is my kickoff point, and from I'm taken the build. I'm building the well. Okay. Now at this particular point, I would have measured some inclination azimuth. Okay. Now second point may be this. So, okay. So the point where I'm recording my inclination and azimuth, or my drilling parameters, so that particular point is my survey point. Okay, that particular point is my survey point. So for this well, this would be my survey point 1 and this would be my survey point 2. All right, okay. So this is my horizontal plan or horizontal plot view. So you can see that I have a rig over here and this is my survey station. Okay, now I have taken a well path in this particular direction. Okay. Now for this particular well path, if I am told to calculate what would be my closure distance, so what I would be doing is that I will be taking the shortest horizontal distance, which is this. Alright. Similarly, if I am told to calculate what would be my closure angle, so this would be my closure angle. Alright. Okay. Coming to bit fork, or the tendency for the bit to wander off the course by the following following the direction of rotation. Okay. Right direction. Okay. That means if I am drilling, okay. That means if I'm, let's take, this is my plan view that I'm discussing, okay, or this horizontal view. Now, if I'm supposed to drill through this particular course, my bit will try to drill, that means it will go off course and try to drill in the right direction. An inherent property of the bit to always go off course, okay, that means it will try to walk in the right direction. Now, coming to reactive torque, the tendency of the drill string to turn in the opposite direction from that of the bit. Okay, that means there will be always a reactive torque. Reactive, again, the term itself says that, like based on the third law of motion, for every action you have a equal and opposite reaction. Okay, that means if I am trying to move in the right direction, there will be a reactive torque experienced in the opposite direction. Similarly, if I am going to drill in the left direction, I will be experiencing a reactive torque in the right side direction. Okay. So we should always take into consideration this reactive torque term also before going for a well path determination. Now this effect must be considered when setting the tool face in the directional drilling when using a downhole motor. Okay. Now coming to lead angle. Lead angle means the direction at which the directional driller aims the well to compensate for the bit fork. Lead angle is measured in degrees left or right of the proposed direction. Again, as we all know, as I've already discussed, my bit will always try to walk in the right direction. To compensate that particular bit walk, I will be giving a lead angle. Okay, now let's move further. Applications of directional drilling. First is inaccessible locations. As you all can see that, I have in this particular figure, you can see that there's a drilling rig over here and my target is located beneath this city area. Okay, now since I cannot set up a drilling rig between the city, I am going to a remote location, remote area, and from remote area I would be drilling a well. Okay, now to reach this particular target, I obviously have to go for a directional well. Second is multiple wells from a single location. Generally in offshore there will be constraint for having platforms. Okay, now you cannot have a, for individual well you cannot have a separate platform. Okay, so from a single platform itself I will be drilling various wells. Okay, now I can be having different targets at different locations. Okay, and I have to drill from a single platform. Okay, in this particular case what I will be going for is a pair drilling. That means from a single location itself I will be drilling, I will be deviating my well and I will be reaching my target. Okay, so this, but that means in offshore specifically when I have to drill multiple wells from a single location, I will be going for a directional well. Okay, now coming to third point, which is the relief well drilling. Now again, relief well I have discussed in my tertiary well control. Whenever my primary and my secondary well control is lost, at that time to regain my primary and secondary well control I will be going for a tertiary well control, which is drilling a relief well. Okay, now the relief well I am drilling, main reason is to intercept the original well. Okay, to intercept the original well and to pump kill mud to the original well so that I can control the influx which is coming from the original well to the surface. Okay, this relief well would be obviously directional in nature because I have to intercept that particular well. Okay. Next point is sidetracking. Now you can see that, let's say this was my original well path. Okay, in this particular figure you can see that this was my original well path. Okay, because of some reason it may be there would have been a chance where I would have lost my tool in the well bore. Okay, now, and I also tried to go for a fishing job, but unfortunately I was not able to remove that particular tool from the original well. Okay, now you cannot lose that particular well. Okay, because we have already put enough amount of money to drill a well. Okay, so what you will be doing is that instead of going through the original well path, I will be taking a sidetrack. Okay, I will be drilling a sidetrack well and then I reach my target well location. Okay, so this is my sidetracking process, and directional drilling comes into play in this particular case. Next point is fault drilling. As we all know, it becomes very difficult to drill through a fault. So to drill through the fault, I will be going for a directional well. Similarly, salt dome also, the salt formations, whatever we are having in beneath this earth surface, these are very difficult to be drilled. Okay, that means there are high chances this salt can get dissolved and my wellbore may collapse. So to avoid this, if I am having target oil in the salt dome, I would be going for a directional wells. All right, okay, let's move further. Type of directional wells. I'm having basically three types of directional wells. Type 1, which is build and hold. Type 2, which is build, hold and drop, or S type. And type 3, which is continuous build. Let's discuss each type in detail. Type 1, which is build and hold, or commonly termed as L type. This is the most common and simplest profile for a directional well. The well is drilled down vertically to the kickoff point, where the well is deviated to the required inclination and further maintained to the target. As you can see that my well has been drilled to the kickoff point, and from the kickoff point I have created some sort of a build, and then I have hold. Then I have created a hold section, or a slant section, or a tangent section. Shallow KOP selected to reduce the inclination. This profile can be applied where large displacements are required at relatively shallow target depths. Used under normal condition, inclination should be within the range of 15 to 55 degree. Alright, okay. Now let's discuss an example. Over here, the question given is, drill a vertical section to a depth of 200 meter to reach the kickoff point and commence the build-up section. So you can see that in this particular figure, there is a vertical section of 200 meter, and from that 200 meter, a kickoff point has been mentioned. During the build-up section, increase the angle of inclination to the vertical by 3 degree every 10 meter along the borehole until you reach 40 degree. Okay, that means by 3 degree you have continuously have to build till you reach the 40 degree end of build. Okay, at this particular point I will be having a 40 degree end of build. So we need to calculate what is my TVD or true vertical depth when we have reached the end of build. What is the measured depth along the borehole from the surface to the EOB? That means we have to calculate the TVD, we have to calculate the measured depth, and third point is we need to calculate the horizontal displacement at EOB. That means we also need to calculate this particular portion. That means the horizontal displacement from the vertical to the end of build. Okay, now let's look at the solution. It's a very simple numerical, but it's conceptually very important, and this type of question has been asked in GATE examination. Okay, so let's look at the solution part. Now it is already given that for every 3 degree, that means for every 10 meter 3 degree inclination angle has been given. So when I reach till 40 degree, what would be my vertical height? That would be equal to 133.3. that means the total vertical depth would be 200 plus 133.3. okay, this is 133.3, which I have already obtained from the numerical. All right, okay, so this is how you calculate my TVD. Now coming to second part, which is my measured depth. So from the figure you can see that let this be my 180 degree. Okay, so theta plus 90 plus 40 degree would be equal to 180. Okay, now if I want to calculate what will be the theta, theta would be equal to 180 minus 90 minus 40, which is equal to 50 degree. Okay, now if I'm having this theta as 50 degree, this is my right angle, so I can get this angle B as equal to 40 degree. As we can see that this is a arc. Okay, let this be the arc and let this be the center of a circle. Okay, now if I'm plotting this, okay, if I'm constructing the entire circle, this would be my radius of the circle. Okay, so if this is my radius of circle, then this will be also equal to the radius of circle. All right, okay, now my radius of curvature would be equal to 180 by pi theta. Okay, now 180 upon pi, that is 3.14, and theta, as we all know, that for every 10 meter I have a angle of 3 degree. Okay, so theta will be 3 degree per every 10 meter. Okay, now by doing this, my r or the radius would be equal to 191.1 meter. Okay, all right, now I have my r, and now if I want to calculate what would be the measured depth. Okay, so my measured depth would be 200, which is already this thing, plus r sine b. Okay, that means this would be my r. Okay, r sine b. Now 200 plus r is 191.1 sine 40 or sine b, which will be equal to 322.8 meter. Okay, now if I am told to calculate what would be my displacement or the horizontal displacement at the end of build, for that what I will be doing is that, as you all know, for cos b, if I want to calculate cos b, okay, for cos b will be equal to r minus x. Cos b will be equal to r minus x upon r. Okay, again very obvious, so that would be r minus x. Cos b will be equal to r minus x upon r. Okay, so x would be equal to r 1 minus cos b. So horizontal displacement will be 191.1 into 1 minus cos 40 will be 44.7 meter. All right, so this is how you calculate my TVD, measured depth, and horizontal displacement at the end of build. All right, okay, this is a very simple numerical. Now let's move further. I have a numerical for you guys. In this particular numerical, it is decided to drill under the lake to the location designed designated. For this well, a build and a hole trajectory will be used. Horizontal departure to the target is 2655 feet. You can see that this 2655 feet is the horizontal departure. So point B is my target point at a TVD of 9650 feet. So the TVD for here is 9650 feet. The recommended rate of build is 2 degree per 100 feet. All right, the kickoff point or the kickoff depth is 1600 feet. You can see that at the 1600 feet, it's my KOP or the kickoff depth. Now we need to determine the radius of curvature, the maximum inclination angle theta, the measured depth to the end of build, the total measured depth, horizontal departure to the end of build. Measured depth at a TVD of 1915 feet. The horizontal departure at a TVD of 1915 feet. The measured depth at a TVD of 7614 feet. And the horizontal departure at 7614 feet. Okay. So at 1915 feet, that means at this point we need to find out what is my TVD and at 1915 feet we need to find out what is my measured depth and my horizontal departure, and similarly at 7614 feet also I need to calculate what is my measured depth and horizontal departure. Okay, it's a very simple numerical. So what we have to do is that, as we know from the KOP, I have started my build. Okay, I have started my build process. That means point C is my end of build point. Alright, point C is my end of build point. That means if I'm constructing a triangle over here, considering this as the arc of this, considering this particular thing as my arc length, so this will be my radius of curvature. Okay, R1 will be radius of curvature, this will be also be R1. Okay, now as we know, this will be a theta for the maximum angle of inclination. So this obviously will be my theta. Now as we know, the target point is point B is my target. So what I will be doing is that I will be plotting a line OB, and my angle between angle at point O will be 90 minus ohm for this triangle of OCB. Okay, and as we know that CB, point CB, will be my whole section or the tangent section. Now if I'm plotting a vertical line from point A, that means OA would be the TVD between my KOP and my target. Okay, alright, so this angle will be tau. So I am having three angles over here, that is theta, 90 minus ohm and tau. Alright, okay. So alright, now taking this geometry into consideration, let's calculate each and every points that has been given in the question. Radius of curvature, as we all know, to find out the radius of curvature, R, which will be equal to 180 upon theta, 180 upon pi theta. So 180 upon pi, which is 3.14, and theta, as we know, it is 2 degree per every 100 feet. Now taking that into consideration, my R or the radius of curvature would be 2866.24 feet. Alright, so I have calculated my R. Now to calculate what is the maximum inclination angle, as we know from this particular geometry, my theta plus 90 minus ohm plus tau will be equal to 90, which gives me my theta equal to ohm minus tau. Alright, now tan tau over here will be equal to AB upon OA. So from this figure I can get that my AB, that is R1 minus X3, and OA, which is D3 minus D1, that is D3 is 9650 feet and D1 is 1600 feet. Okay, now tau will be equal to tan inverse of, if I'm putting all these values of R1, X3, D3 and D1, I will be getting my tau as 1.5 degree. Okay, now coming to cos tau would be equal to D3 minus D1 upon OB, obvious. Okay, from that I can get my OB as 8057.26 meter feet. Okay, 8057 feet. Now if I have tau, I have theta. Now let's calculate what is ohm. Okay, to calculate ohm, from this same figure only I can get my cos 90 minus ohm. Okay, in this particular figure, if I want to calculate this cos 90 minus ohm, that will be equal to R1 upon OB. Okay, that will be equal to R1 upon OB. OB we have already calculated. Okay, see, OB we have already got from this earlier concept, we have got OB. Okay, once we have OB, so my cos 90 minus ohm, which will be equal to sin ohm, from that I will get my ohm as 20 degree. That means, as we already know, that theta equal to ohm minus 90, so theta equal to 20.85 minus 1.5, my theta will be equal to 19.33 degree. Okay, so my maximum inclination angle is 19.33 for this particular question. Now to find out what would be the measured depth to the end of build, so to find out the measured depth to the end of build, first I have to add the Yeah, vertical distance that is from the calibushing height to the KOP I have been already given. It is 1600 feet plus 19.34 upon my given angle. Okay, that is plus 19.34 upon theta, where theta is my build angle. Okay, so 19.34 divided by 2 into 100. So my measured depth to the end of build will be equal to 2567 feet. A very simple concept, right? Now coming to point 4, which is the total measured depth. We have the measured depth till this end of build, so we need to calculate this this particular distance also. Okay, for this particular distance we know my omega is if I want to calculate this particular thing, then I have a radius of curvature. So my tan omega, okay, that means tan omega will be equal to r upon this particular distance. Okay, let's say x. Okay, now x is equal to r upon tan omega. So my total measured depth will be 1600 with this tilt kickoff point plus 19.34 upon build angle plus r upon tan omega. On putting these values, I will be getting my total measured depth till the point of target as 10,091 feet. Now to find out the horizontal departure towards my end of build, that means this particular point, for this particular point, that will be equal to r, that will be equal to r minus r1 cos theta. Okay, by using the geometry only I can get my horizontal departure towards end of build, which is equal to r minus r1 cos theta. On placing the values, I will be getting 161.6 feet. To calculate my measured depth at 1915 feet, what I will be doing is that I will be taking a small triangle where my angle will be beta. We know 2806 as my radius of curvature, and and 1915 feet minus 1600 feet will be giving me 315. Okay, by using this triangle I can get my beta as 6.3 degree. Now it will be easy now to calculate my measured depth and horizontal displacement. All you have to do is that you have to use the geometry. Alright, okay. Now to find out my measured depth and the horizontal departure at 7614 feet. So let this point be 761. This is my point of 7614 feet. Okay. Now measured depth, to calculate the measured depth, I have my measured depth till end of build point. We have calculated it in the last slide. So 1600 plus 19.34 upon 2 upon 100 plus CP dash. Okay. Now to calculate this CP dash, I will be creating another triangle over here. Alright, so from this triangle, by using the geometry, I can get my final measured depth at 7614 feet as 7935 feet. Now to find out my measured depth and the horizontal departure at 7614 feet, so let this point be 761. This is my point of 7614 feet. Okay, now measured depth, to calculate the measured depth, I have my measured depth till end of build point. We have calculated it in the last slide. So 1600 plus 19.34 upon 2 upon 100 plus CP dash. Okay. Now to calculate this CP dash, I will be creating another triangle over here. Alright. So from this triangle, by using the geometry, I can get my final measured depth at 7614 feet as 7935 feet. Now this is the triangle that I have used for calculating this particular problem. I guess you should all calculate by yourself. Now coming to horizontal departure, again using the same triangle, I can calculate this, and my final answer, that is my horizontal departure at 7614 feet, will be equal to 1935.5 feet. Alright, okay. Now let's move further. Coming to the type 2 or the build, hold and drop section or S type. Okay. Now this profile is similar to type 1 up to tangential section. Here the profile enters a drop section where the inclination is reduced and in some cases below the vertical as it reaches the target. More torque and drag can be expected due to the additional bend. You can see that from the kickoff point I have taken a build section, then I have gone for a hold or a slant section, and from this particular point, that is the top of drop, I have taken a drop section. That means I have continuously decreased my angle till I reach my target. Alright, okay. Now it is used where my target is deep but horizontal displacement is relatively small. It has also application when completing a well through intersect multiple producing zones. Drilling of relief well where it is necessary to run parallel to wild well, and lease or target limitations. Okay, when you have all these cases, at that time you will go for a S type or a build, hold and drop section. Alright, okay, let's move further. Type 3, or commonly termed as deep kickoff and build J type well. Okay, type 3 or a deep kickoff well or a build J type well. Alright, so here you can see that my kickoff point is very deep and then I'm going for a build section and a slant section. Now this is a J type well, this is a J type well. Initial deflection is started well below the surface and angle is built up to the bottom. It is used in particular situation like salt drum drilling, fault drilling and or side tracking or repositioning of the target. Disadvantages are formation may be harder and less responsive to the deflection. More tripping time to change bottom hole assembly while deflecting, and build up rate is more difficult to control.